How are we doing? Welcome to Catch the Fire.
Yay! Are you excited about this week? We're excited,
It's going to be a great, great week.
It is.
For those of you who don't know me, my name's Steve Long. This is Carol Arnott. And we are live right now on Catch the Fire TV. So hello, everybody all around the world that you're watching us on our website, ctftoronto.com. And you need to know that tonight at 8:30, we go live around the world on Daystar TV. So every night.
Isn't that amazing?
Yep. Hey. Marcus and Joni Lamb have a 1.5 hour live TV show from 8:30 Eastern time to 10 o'clock PM. And so they're giving us their time slot all week. And Marcus will be here tomorrow night. So what that means is we're gonna worship and then we're gonna do some housekeeping stuff. We're gonna do some announcement kind of things. And then we're gonna have a countdown to go live. And so you're pretending that we're starting all over again. Would that be all right? So that's sort of how it goes. It's TV, and there'll be a count out as well, probably, that John, who's preaching tonight, will just say goodbye to everybody, and then we just, you know, we have our own little party after that. So we're off the air, and now we don't have to behave anymore.
Yeah.
You don't have to behave as well. Please don't do that.
I break that off.
Yeah. If you're behaving, people are going to go, that's not Toronto. They're behaving, so anyways. Shall we stand up and welcome the Holy Spirit and we'll worship tonight?
Holy Spirit, we just so welcome you tonight. Lord, you just come and do what you love to do. Come and bless your people. Lord, lead us into worshiping the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Ah, Lord, we just dust everyone off from all the busyness, from all the travel, of all the things that would hinder. And Lord, we just choose to step back into your arms of love. Lord, we want to worship you full on with all of our hearts. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen. I have a question. How many of you come from a church where you're not allowed to be up at the front during the worship time? You need to come. This is your chance to come and just sort of feel what it's like to be up at the front. So if you'd like to worship up at the front, come on up. This is Marcel and Ruth Preston.
Woo-hoo!
And they're going to lead us this next time here. Come, Holy Spirit.
Praise the Lord. Oh. There's a longing, there's a crying out in the spirit tonight. And he's here, he's here, he's here. Oh, God, we long to worship you. Our hearts cry out, our bodies cry out. Yeah. Come on, let's sing, I will lift up. And I will lift up my eyes to your throne. My eyes to your throne.
My eyes to your throne.
I will trust you.
And I will trust you.
I will trust you.
I will trust you alone.
Yeah, I will lift up.
Because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good to me. Knows no bounds. Your goodness never stops. Your mercy follows me. Your kindness fills my life. Your love amazes me. Yeah. And I sing because you are good. And I dance because you are good. And I shout because you are good. You are good. You are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good to me. You are good to me. You are good. Nothing and no one comes anywhere close to you. The earth and oceans deep only reflect because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good to me, and I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good.
Dare not to rest
the sweetest friend. But hold just in Jesus' name. Christ alone. Oh, Christ alone. Cornerstone. Weak made strong. In the Savior's love. And through the storm. He is Lord. He is Lord of all. Jesus Christ is Lord, high above the rest. And every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, high above the rest. Sing that with me. And every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, high above the rest. Yeah. And every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, high. Yeah, sing this over our families tonight.
Give our love.
resurrection life begin to flow through every body, heart, soul, and mind. Yes, Lord, begin to flow.
The moon and stars wept, the morning sun was dead, the Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse was broken. The weight of every curse was broken. The power of hell forever. sing hallelujah.
We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing
sing hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome. Thank you.
say your song, bubble up. Just think about the Lord, think about Jesus. And let your own song begin to bubble up out of you. When you have something, just sing it out. It doesn't have to sound good. It doesn't have to be pretty. Just make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Just begin to sing out your own song. Begin to lift him up. Even if it's just a sound, even if it's just one note, just begin to lift him up tonight. Begin to sing out. Begin to sing out. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Dad, just give him a shout. Give him a shout of praise. Just honor him in this place. We love you, Jesus. We love you.
Oh, Father, we bless you tonight.
Worship you.
Just lift his
Thank
name up.
Lord.
Father, you're not just worthy. Fill in the blank. You are also, just sing it to him. Say it to him. Just say it. Father, you're an amazing Father. Amazing Father. Best daddy we've ever had.
Amen.
We bless you, Father. Thank you, Father, so much. Well, friends, welcome. I think this is Catch the Fire number
21.
Is it 21 or 22? First one
22.
First one was 1994.
That's right.
1994, okay. September. Yep. Anyways, welcome, everybody. Before you head back to your seat, how about you just welcome three or four people, find out what country they're from. If they're from the same country, find out what city they're from. If it's the same city, find out what street they're from. And if they happen to be married to you, you can give them a kiss. So again, welcome to all of you that are watching on Catch Fire TV. And just really glad that you joined us for our annual Catch the Fire conference. So God bless you all. Hopefully you can join us all week long. And we're going to be here 10 a.m. tomorrow morning Eastern time, 2 in the afternoon, 7 o'clock every night the rest of this week. So hopefully you can join us for that. Welcome, Carol.
Yes, Steve. This is exciting.
This is very exciting.
It is really exciting, and we're so glad you're here.
We are going to have a great, great time.
Yeah, and everybody watching on TV Live, we welcome you as well. It's wonderful to have them.
Great. So, folks, if you can head back to your seats, that would be good. And I was sitting, I have a front row seat, and Dan Slade, can you get the attention of Lou behind you? I happen to see Lou Engel. I saw Lou Engel. How many of you know Lou Engel? Guess what Lou was doing? Praying. Lou, come on up and say hi to everybody. Shall we welcome Lou Engel, amazing man of God. Gathers people all around the world to pray.
Say hi to everyone.
Well, it's great to be back in the well.
I know. It's great to have you back, Lou.
I'm a son of Toronto.
You are.
And the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And our whole lives were changed out of that outpouring. Who could have dreamed the things that came out of it? So thank you. And it's great to be back with you, John. Great to be back with you, Carol. Love you.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
So God has told you to sell the farm. Where are you going?
Do you want me to tell the story?
Yeah, tell it quickly.
Later.
Okay.
We'll tell the story later.
Okay.
Love you.
So, hold it. Where are you going?
I don't know.
Lou! Fire on you, Lou.
If Carol's beside you, that means prayer.
More on Lou, Lord. Fill him up for the next run, Lord. More.
Come on up. We have just finished a wonderful Partners in Harvest Pastors Conference. How many were at the Partners in Harvest Pastors? Yay. So there was about 250 pastors and leaders from 10,000 plus churches that we're
a part of. It's amazing. And we want to welcome our partners in Harvest here, those who have stayed on. We're so glad you came for our conference and that you can stay for this. Keep on receiving. Keep on getting more.
Keep on getting more, Dan.
Arriba. Okay. Anyways, I'm really glad to be next to this man.
Amen.
Because last night I spoke on a vineyard and what a healthy vineyard looks like. And of course, that's a local church. And every vineyard in Mark 12 has a good tower in it. And that tower is a watchtower to look for the enemies and to have a prophetic tower. And so the wine, that is the vineyard, and the prayer tower always go together. And so I think it's very significant that Lou is here, you know, here in the wine at the wine center of the world, so to speak. Arriba, and help us to build the towers, Lou, in the wine centers. Amen.
Come on.
Bless you, Dan. Where are you going?
Carol.
Okay, wants to go to Carol. Well, I would too. Well, can we find out where people are from? If you're an American, can you stand up? Where's the Americans? Glad to have you. Yay. You are the best neighbors Canada's ever had. So God bless you. You may be seated. If you are from the UK, can I get you to stand up? UK and Ireland. Yay, there's people all over. Wonderful. Yay. If you are from somewhere else in Europe, because the UK guys, they're not so sure that they're part of Europe. But if you're part of Europe, can I get you to stand up? Here's the Europeans. Yay, look at this. Big groups. Excellent. You may be seated. Let's go south. Is there anyone here from Africa? I saw some Africans. Yay. Over here as well. God bless you. Wonderful. That's where I grew up. I grew up in Malawi.
I did.
My first 5 years were missionary kid in Malawi, Africa.
Come on,
very,
Steve.
Very, very good. What about somewhere in Asia? Anyone from India, Pakistan, China, Cambodia, any of those kind of places. Where are your friends? Right over here. I met this brother this morning. God bless you. And Australia, Australasia, Philippines, woo! Fiji, all those places.
Oh,
great.
My goodness.
Thank you. And let's go to South America. Anyone from South or Central America, please stand up. Colombia. Brazil. Yay, yay. Glad that you're here. Let's go north. Canada, where are you? Perfect. Yay. It almost looked like we were doing a wave there for a moment.
So. I know, it did, didn't it,
maybe,
Steve?
Maybe
let's
we'll, do you want to do one?
Yeah, let's do a wave.
Should we do a wave? Should we wait for TV to do that, or would that be too... that'd be all right. We need the drummer. Where's our drummer? Come. Who's coming? Is the drummer coming? Do you know how to do the wave? So those of you at the back, when we say go or whatever we say go, you stand up, put your hands in the air, yell, scream, Jesus, and then we just sort of move it up to the front. Is that all right? How many of you have done this in church before? We need a drum roll. Good drum roll. You know this is in the book of Leviticus. This is in the Bible. It's called a wave offering. It's all the way through the book of Leviticus. It's in the Bible. I'm a Baptist. I know. I used to be a Baptist. It's in the Bible.
All right.
All right. Are you ready in the back? Ready? Drum roll, please. No, more. Louder. All right. One, two, three. Go from the back.
Go. Woo.
Jesus! Woo! Yay! Now that was okay.
We need to try that again.
We need to definitely. That was the warm-up. That was the warm-up.
Yeah.
Are you ready again, sir? Our drummer is imported from Catch Fire Montreal. At the back. One, two, three, go! Jesus, I love doing that.
That's great, isn't it?
I like going to sporting events, and that's one of the good things that happens if your team is losing badly. You do things to do just to fill time up.
Oh.
So, but the Blue Jays are now doing it because they're winning. So
I
that's
know.
A good thing.
Yay.
Well, can I tell you because we're not on the national, we're not on the Daystar yet. We're joining them, or they're joining us at 8:30. But I had this theory about the Toronto Blue Jays and Benny Hinn. Can I tell you what that is? Benny was here Thursday night and Friday night.
Right.
Toronto Blue Jays won both those nights.
Huh.
He went to Montreal Saturday and Sunday. Toronto lost. He came back to Toronto Monday night. Toronto won.
Oh, come on.
He wasn't here last night. Toronto lost.
Oh.
So I think we should be inviting Benny John for a month, 2 months until the World Series is over.
Oh, well, we've asked
how
him
many,
for 30
how many
days.
Think that would be a good idea. Anyways, I don't think I have enough suits for that, but anyways.
That we can fix, Steve.
I suppose we could fix that.
Yeah.
So, Carol, what's your best part of being a part of this church?
Oh, Steve, the Holy Spirit.
So how about we welcome the Holy Spirit? Can we do that? Everyone stand up. We're going to just get you full of the Holy Spirit. That's what Catch the Fire Conference is all about. It's just drinking, getting full, being baptized in the Holy Spirit, and fire. Go ahead, Carol.
Now, I want you to, just as we're praying, Benny made a really interesting comment about siphoning the Holy Spirit in. He had to do that when he had to fill a gas can in Israel. In order to pump it into a gas can, he had to siphon it and then spit it out. But we're not going to spit the Holy Spirit out. We're going to siphon it and take him in. Okay? So we're going to drink in the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, would you come?
Ooh.
Wow. We invite you. Wow. Just to come. And we just breathe and drink and siphon. Whoa! You in, Holy Spirit.
Ooh.
Oh.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Just more.
I found it's really hard to drink if you don't have your mouth open.
Oh.
That's called drooling.
Just drink him in. Oh.
I found that tilting my head back a little bit helps as well. And I've also found that going glug, glug, glug really helps.
Whoa, Steve, it's getting really hot up here. Whew. Just keep drinking. Holy Spirit, come and just touch your people, Lord. Oh, let your wonderful presence just go through as we just focus on you, Lord.
I think you should put your right hand on a person around you and say more. Say, keep drinking.
More, Steve.
That was your left hand. It's the right hand. Oh, Jesus.
Oh, dear. Fill him up, Lord. Yo, that feels better, Steve. More Holy Spirit, just flow. We love your presence. We honor you. We bless you. Oh, Lord, do you want to come and lift Jesus higher this week? Holy Spirit, we give you permission in our lives just to come and fill us. Come and love us.
Okay, now use your left hand. Now use your left hand.
I don't know my left or my right, Steve.
Oh, Jesus. Find the person in front of you, behind you. If it doesn't look like they're drinking, show them how to do it.
Whoa.
Oh, Holy Spirit, come.
Holy Spirit, you are good, you are good, you are good. More.
Thank you, Father.
More. Just let it come. Whoa.
Holy Spirit, come.
Ha. Fill them, fill them, fill them, fill them. Whoa. Drink, 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 drink. Ah. Ooh, more. More. Ah. Cha.
Our church. You remember in the book of Acts, in Acts chapter 1, Jesus told his disciples that they needed more. And it turned out that it was 10 days from when he said that to when the Holy Spirit came in Acts chapter 2. So we decided at our church this year, all the Catch the Fire campuses in Toronto, that we would have 10 days of waiting. And we just had Holy Spirit meetings where there was no agenda other than to wait, pray, worship, and just welcome the Holy Spirit.
Right.
And we had so much fun. And one of the things that we did was Bill Johnson, from our friend from Bethel Reading, sent John Arnott an old video of a Kenneth Hagin camp meeting.
Right.
Remember that, Carol?
Oh, it was just unbelievable.
And we showed that at some of our meetings, and it was just bedlam.
Yeah.
Bedlam.
Yeah.
Of the Holy Spirit. Trevor, you were at one of those. Oh, Trevor's out. Can we get Trevor? Duncan? Duncan, can you see if we can get Trevor up? Trevor used to go to these. He used to live in St. Louis.
Oh, really?
Where Kenneth Hagin was having these camp meetings.
Oh, cool, Trev.
Tell people what that was like, Trev. Trevor's the pastor of Catch the Fire Winnipeg.
It was amazing. He was, he'd walk around and they'd need people to hold him up. A friend of mine was there and he was sitting in a chair like this. And when the power of God hit him, He sat down on his chair, and the legs on the chair, the kabod was so heavy, the legs bent up like this.
Oh, my gosh.
All four legs.
Metal ones.
Yeah, just like these ones, like these
tubes,
you know? And he actually hung it on his wall as a trophy when he really met the Lord.
Oh, yeah. How cool.
It was very, very good. More Holy Spirit for Trevor.
Fire on you, Trevor.
Oh, Holy Spirit, come. Come.
Shabbat.
Come.
Ha.
Oh, Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Oh, have you had a good drink? Well, we're going to have some times of refreshing
more?
This week just to be strengthened in your inner man, inner woman, whatever it's called, your spirit man, spirit person, and just to get full and full and full. Our world doesn't need people who are dry. It needs people who are full of the Holy Spirit. I have a few little
He's being sneaky. He's pulling a Carol on me.
he's going for Carol's feet. I have a few things that you can get in our resource center, and we have lots and lots of wonderful Holy Spirit things. You may not know this, but when we say our church is named Catch the Fire, and it's not just talking about being full of the Holy Spirit and fire. The word fire is an acrostic for Catch the Fire and for the Partners in Harvest Churches worldwide. And the acrostic is F stands for the Father's love, I stands for intimacy, oneness. We want everyone to know Jesus and to be able to connect with him, hear his voice, all that kind of stuff. R is about renewing your heart. And you remember that Jesus said two of the five purposes of the anointing are to set captives free and heal broken hearts. And so that's all about you and your past. And then the E is all about empowering, equipping. Anything that Jesus did, we want all the people in our church to be able to do that. And so most of the resources that we have are on one of those four topics. And we're going to mention this a little bit later on, but Ruth and Marcel have a brand new live soaking CD. It's called Living Waters. They were the ones that were up here. They lead our central campus, which is a downtown young adults, more than young adults, but it's primarily young adults that are at that campus. And you want to just hold that up? It has just been nominated for Gospel Music Award for the best CD of the year.
It's great. You want to soak? Get this. Yeah. It's amazing.
I think it's like 90 minutes.
Yeah.
It's very, very good.
Yeah, it's really good.
John and Carol have three or four different versions of a book on forgiveness. And the latest version, Trevor, you have to turn around backwards. I have a one-year-old. Yeah, that's how you have to go down. That's it. The most up-to-date version of the first book that they wrote, which was called The Importance of Forgiveness, is called Grace and Forgiveness. It's a great little book. Every newcomer that comes to any of our Toronto campuses, this is what they get given free their first Sunday. It's sort of the foundational talk of our church, is that followers of Jesus do much better when they learn to forgive.
Much better,
much
Steve.
Better. And John and Carol wrote a book called The Invitation, and this is their newest book, and it's all about what's happening actually right now, the end time scenarios, the different possibilities. And as John Bootsman, who's the campus pastor here for the airport campus, preached an amazing sermon about the end times, and it's all about Jesus. And so the invitation is from Jesus to have an intimate relationship with him. And did you want to say anything more on that one?
No,
that's good. You were one of the authors, so you have to be humble. And we don't have
to.
You don't have to, but this is a history book of what God has been doing here for the last 20 years, and it's called From Here to the Nations. And John's very first church that he planted in Stratford, Ontario, which is 90 minutes east of here, the most famous member of his church is a guy named Justin Bieber. John's associate pastor is the guy who wrote this book. Jerry is an amazing researcher, and I was pleasantly surprised. I was thinking it's just going to be boring history, like this happened this day, this happened this day. No, it's full of stories. It's full of insights, testimonies of people. Great, great book called From Here to the Stories of Revival. Yeah, that's exactly what it's all about. So all of those are in our resource center, and you can help yourself anytime that you'd like to do that a little bit later on. Carol, where's my cheat sheet? I need to just talk about a couple announcements for those of you that are here for the conference. Did you get one of these? Who said no? The no people would be people who haven't picked up their registration badge and or who are maybe just here for the evening or snuck in or, John, I saw your daughter related to John Arnott. Maybe that would be a reason they don't have one. Anyways, all the information for the conference hopefully is in here. And if you can't find what you need in here, head to the welcome desk in the lobby and our staff there would be really happy to help you with that. And a couple practical things for you. Let me just go over this list. And number one, it says, welcome everybody. Did we do that? Yes, okay, done. Talk about the speakers. Carol, who is speaking tomorrow night? That's not a rhetorical question.
I had to think of it.
It is Marcus Lamb. Marcus Lamb is gonna be here from Daystar TV. You've met him, what's he like?
He is really nice. In the early days, they had us on there program, and they just love the river and the Holy Spirit. Yeah. So you will enjoy him tomorrow night. We are looking forward to connecting again, and you know how you get going, and you're going in this direction, they're going in another direction, and yeah. So now the convergence again, which is really going to be amazing. So we're really, really excited about that, Steve.
For those of you who don't watch Daystar, it is one of the, probably yeah. the most revival-friendly yes. yeah. Christian TV stations, I would say. Yeah. And tomorrow night, they're going to be here. Joni's going to be here. Yeah. They're bringing some of the musicians.
Oh, great.
So for those of you fabulous. Who like their program on Daystar mm-hmm. TV, 8:30 Eastern Time, it's basically going to be a replica of that tomorrow night. So it'll, for the TV audience around the world, they're going to sort of think it's normal, but it happens to be live from Toronto. So that's going to be good. Friday night, who's our guest?
Kenneth Copeland.
Kenneth Copeland. What is Kenneth like?
Oh, Kenneth is amazing. We had met him in Rome for the very first time, and oh, he just really blessed my heart. I was just really humbled by him, amazed by him, his gentleness, his humility, his lovingness. You're going to enjoy him. I was, to tell you the truth, I'm going to apologize to him personally for some judgments I made over the years when I first got saved. I received kind of slanted news and believed it and didn't check it out. And so I'm going to apologize to him face to face. And because he really blessed me in Rome. So you're going to enjoy him.
Yeah. And Kenneth is also going to be with us Saturday morning as well. And Friday night, for those of you who live in the GTA or have friends in the GTA, Greater Toronto Area, Friday night is an open night. Anyone can come, no admittance. Yep. And it's our missions offering night, so we'll tell you about that. The other nights, we don't take an offering because we have an entrance fee to be able to come. Saturday night, Reinhard Bonnke led more people to Jesus than anyone in the history of the world.
And he's another one that's extremely humble.
Yes.
Which is just amazing. It was a privilege and an honor to get to know Reinhard, too. We had him on one of the Catch the Fire cruises. And it was really fun to get to know him.
He is such a funny man.
He is.
Duncan Smith, where are you? You're going to be one of the speakers. Can you please stand up? From Catch Fire Raleigh. Can I tell your story about meeting Reinhard for the first time, or would you like to tell that story? One of our pastors phoned John Arnott to say, did you know that Reinhard Bonnke is in Toronto and he's at such and such a restaurant just around the corner?
Yeah.
Well, Duncan was in the car and heard that. And it's like, we're going. Duncan grew up in Nigeria, where Reinhard has done much of his ministry, had at one meeting, 1 million people filled in cards to give their lives to Jesus. Wow. Huge, huge meetings. And so they went, and Duncan just went in. Am I right? Went up to him in the restaurant, excuse me, da-da-da-da-da-da. Your friend John Arnott's in the parking lot. I'm with him, So anyways, Reinhard, after the meal, comes out. And John Arnott, we'll get you to talk about what's good about him in a minute.
Everything.
Give you some time to think about it, Carol.
No, I just thought about it. Everything.
Okay. Anyways, when they're meeting in the parking lot, like, 1 minute, 2 minute drive from here is where they were meeting. And John likes to tease people. And he said, Reinhard, did you know that this young man here has been listening to your sermon tapes for years, and he can imitate you. He can talk, he can preach like you.
Yeah.
So Reinhard was sort of in a playful mood. And you, Duncan, you did it. You did your best impression. And Reinhard he goes, that was one of my best sermons, or however he says it.
Yeah,
And
he says, I haven't preached that sermon in years.
How did he say it? How did you say it? How did he say it?
He said, open the window and shoot! Something like that. He said, take bow and arrow. Open the window and shoot! And Reinhard said, he laughed and laughed and laughed, and then when he recovered laughing, he said, when you were talking like that, you had no accent at all, not at all. So then John says, well, do you know, Reinhard, Duncan grew up in Nigeria, and he can do a perfect Nigerian accent as well, can't you, Duncan? Why don't you show Reinhard your Nigerian accent? I'm like, John, this is just not how this whole thing was, I was hoping it was gonna go. And so Reinhard said, come on, yes, yes, do it, let me see, or something like that, you know, and I need a bit of a polish up, to be honest. But anyway, so right in that moment, I'm like, in the name of Jesus, the word of God says, Matthew chapter 3, verse 1. Well, that was it. Reinhard just lost it at that moment. And he said, I would like you to come to Lagos with me in 2 months' time, young man. I said, it would be my honor.
And Duncan got to go and be at one of his crusades in Africa. When he was on the Catch the Wave cruise with us 3 years ago, Duncan and I, without talking to each other, had both come up with a plan independently, and that is that we were going to get to the dining room early and not take a seat until Reinhard sat down, and we sat on either side pretty well every night. And it's like, if this guy's got something, we're going to get it. If he spits on our plate, we're going to eat it. We're just going to get it. And it was just, I think the last night he said, can I go talk to Heidi Baker? And it's like, yeah, all right. Yeah. So, anyways, the speaker tonight is a guy named John. What's best about him, other than everything?
His love for Jesus. When I first got saved, I listened to preachers on TV, and it was always, they were scolding me, they were yelling at me, they were whatever. And my next door neighbor had a Bible study, and she invited John Arnott to come and teach the Bible study. And I would go and tell my friend, whose name was Grace Kelly. Anyway, not the Grace Kelly, but her name was Grace. I said, Grace, John said, da-da-da-da-da-da, John said, da-da-da-da-da-da, you know, and I would just repeat all this wonderful stuff, these treasures that he would bring out of the Old Testament and out of the New Testament, and it was like, oh, and Grace would say, oh, Carol, all I hear is the gospel according to John.
That's good, isn't it?
That's
so
very
single
good.
Ladies go to Bible studies. I think that's the thing.
Well, I fell in love with him spiritually first,
and
Steve.
Carol's going to be doing a talk, and Carol is the sweetest, kindest lady I've ever met. She is the best at forcing people to stay in the presence of God. That's what she likes to do, don't you, Carol?
I do. I love that.
I obeyed her, knowing that she was watching me, because when Benny Hinn was here, she was sitting up on the stage, and Benny prayed for me a couple times, and I did not get up until I was sort of tapped on the shoulder to move and things like that, knowing that Carol's watching me, and that if I did get up, she's gonna, you know, the eye is gonna be focused on you, and it's like, get down, and so.
That's like, woo.
Anyways, back to the announcements. Doors open tomorrow morning, 8:30. And our first session is 10 a.m., so the rest of the week, 10 a.m., 2 p.m., 7 p.m., and for those of you watching on Catch the Fire TV, we're going to be live at all those sessions, so you can watch us all the sessions all the time, and they're in the archives on YouTube, and so you can watch them 100 times if you'd like. Seats. Yeah. We're not allowed to save your seat overnight. If you do, it'll be a donation to our Lost and Found. And that, at the end of the week, will be donated to a street mission that we have called Followers Mission. And so they especially need men's products. So just to let you know. So take everything home tonight. And if you brought a water bottle in, it would really help if you take that and put it in a trash bin. It's just like hundreds of water bottles are here. And if you can just pick yours up and everyone picks theirs up, it just saves our team 10, 15 minutes just from doing that. And I think that is pretty well good for those kind of things.
Housekeeping is done.
Housekeeping is done.
Notice who did the housekeeping. A man.
Very, very good. Ruth and Marcel, where are you guys? Can you bring the band up? So friends, here's what we're going to do. Right at 8:30, we're going to have a countdown, and we're going to be joined live by Daystar. Where's Mr. Ben? Where's Ben?
Right there.
Ben, like, are we starting with a camera over here? Do we start with a close-up on Carol and I? What do we do? From this camera? From this camera over here. Okay. Are we going to have the people stand up and be clapping? Okay. So we will tell you, like, with about 30 seconds to go, could everyone stand up? When Ben turns to you and goes clap, 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 you pretend that you're enjoying something that's happening. And I would say, Ben, they clap for another 10, 15 seconds. Keep talking while Carol and I are greeting everybody. That'd be all right. We'll just have some fun that way. Ruth and Marcel, can I just talk about these guys while we got 2 minutes to go? Ruth and Marcel are two of the most amazing pastors that we have. And the church that they lead downtown is just a good church. I tell all the campuses this, so if you're from another one campus, don't listen. But that would be my favorite campus. If I had to just choose one, that's where I would go. And Marcel is just a very gifted musician, songwriter, producer. And most years, he's nominated 3-4 different categories of Christian music in Canada. And he was nominated for a Gemini, which is the equivalent, a Juno, sorry, which is the equivalent of a Grammy in the States. So, like, that's sort of the quality and the level that he's at. So, Miss Ruth, what's the best part of being at Catch the Fire? You're just killing time here. We got 3 minutes.
Best part of being at Catch the Fire?
Yeah, you came to the School of Ministry. Talk about that real quick.
I came to the School of Ministry, represent School of Ministry students, come on, 10 years ago. I was an alcoholic. I really needed Jesus. I did not know that you could hear God's voice. And I'd literally been told you couldn't, actually, by Christians. I was a Christian my whole life. And they taught me first week how to hear God's voice. And that is the thing that has radically changed me. I might cry. He's so good, isn't he?
Yeah.
He's so good. And it's amazing how someone can tell you, you know, for me, don't drink, don't drink, don't drink, over and over and over. And you try, and you try, and you try. And then God said to me, a little harshly maybe, but it was lovely when he said it, hey, babe, it's time to stop sinning. Time to stop drinking, okay? He's like, I did not set you free so that you could drink alcohol for me. He's like, I set you free so that you could be free. And I never turned back. That was it. Been free for 4 years, yeah.
Come on,
so,
Jesus.
It's just who he is. It's who he is. He's so good. He's so good.
Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah. And Ruth and Marcel just raise up really good leaders. Marcel, best part of being a songwriter? Can you tell I'm filling time here?
Well, for me, songwriting and recording music is like a window into somebody's life. And I mean, I love the idea of writing hope and of writing about Jesus and about his heart. And then having that impact people. I actually had an awesome testimony. I have a song on radio, and you know, a fellow said that he sent me an email and he said, "Hey, you know, I heard your song on radio, and I had to find it, and it was kind of a pre-release." So he said he downloaded it illegally from YouTube, which I guess he was walking in the light, which was pretty funny. But then he said something that changed my perspective on music. He said, "You know, I was going through a tough time. I was ready to take my life. And I heard your song talking about how Jesus is your safe place. And the heart of that song is that Jesus will never leave us or forsake us." And he said, "I chose not to take my life." And I mean, just the idea that we can have an impact on people that way, it's amazing.
Bless you guys. Very, very good. I forgot, did you tell him to start clapping? No, you're clapping for him. I forgot to welcome our world changers. World changers over here and over here, please stand up. These are amazing people who partner with us. They go on missions trips all around the world and help to financially sow into transforming people's lives. World changers, if you've been on a missions trip, been to one of our 1 week schools, put your hand up. World changers. Yay, so that's a whole bunch of you. We're gonna talk about that just a little bit later. Okay, friends, everyone please stand up. 10 seconds. So Carol, you're going to start us off, or I'm going to say hello and then you're going to go.
Four, three, clap.
Hey everybody.
Yeah.
catch the fire. Carol?
Yeah, this is amazing. And we want to thank Marcus and Joni Lamb and all of the Daystar team. We are so excited that you are going to show Catch the Fire all around the world. Oh, Steve, this that is amazing.
This is our very first time to host Daystar TV live from Toronto.
It is.
And tomorrow night, our Daystar viewers are going to have Joni and Marcus right here in Toronto. And
that's
so we're looking forward
really
to
good.
That.
Yeah.
And then Friday night, Kenneth Copeland's going to be here live in Toronto.
Right. And
Saturday night, Reinhard Bonnke live in Toronto. So it's going to be a great week.
It's going to be in a magnificent
week. So we're just going to go back into some worship, and we have two of our great worship leaders. This is Marcel Preston, his wife Ruth Preston. And are we ready to worship some more? Yeah. Let's do that. Let's do that.
I am free to run.
I am free to run.
I am free to dance.
I am free to dance.
I am free to live for you.
Anybody free in the house?
Here we go. Oh, I am free. One, two, three. Whoa. Whoa. I'm free. Darkness flees. Through you, my heart screams. I'm free. Yeah. I am free to run.
I am free to run.
I am free to dance.
I am free to dance.
I am free to live for you.
Kingdom,
hallelujah, yeah, 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 hallelujah.
the sun sets free, it's free indeed, and ain't no chains that can hinder me. Hallelujah, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Come on, sing that again.
Who the sun sets free, who the sun sets free, it's free indeed, and ain't no chains that can hinder me. Hallelujah, yeah, yeah, yeah. Hallelujah, yeah, yeah. Who the sun sets free, it's free indeed, and ain't no chains that can hinder me. Hallelujah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, oh, yeah.
I am free to love.
I am free to love.
I am free.
To be free. Oh, Steve, amen. Isn't that great?
It's wonderful. Wonderful. Thank you, everybody, for being here tonight with Catch the Fire in Toronto. My name's Steve Long, and my wife Sandra and I, my wife Sandra's right there in the front, and this is Carol Arnott, and her husband John, who's right in the front, started this church 26 years ago.
Amazing. Where did the time go, Steve?
It's evident in gray hair and things like that, I think is what, how it is.
Okay.
You may be seated. And once again, thank you for the privilege, Marcus and Joni, of joining you and all of your amazing people all around the world on Daystar. This is one of the things I was looking forward to. I can't see you, but you're looking good.
They are looking good.
Very, very good.
Yeah.
We have two friends from England that we want to have share their story with you tonight. So, Stu and Chloe, can you come on up here?
Yay!
Stu used to be a veterinarian doctor. And Chloe, I don't know exactly what you used to do. A personal fitness trainer. Uh-huh. Very, very good. And we're going to hear, Chloe, your story first. But just to tell you a little bit of an end story, these folks are now pastors of Catch the Fire London in Wembley, England, right where the big football stadium is and all that kind of stuff. Very, very good. And They have an amazing ministry in Kenya that any of you who would like to go, you can talk to them about joining. But they feed 40,000 kids a day. Yeah. Sorry, a day or a week? A week. 40,000 kids a week are fed through their Kenya project. And so you guys are just doing amazing.
Amazing.
So, Carol, find out what happened to Chloe.
Chloe, I just want to talk to you for a minute. Stu, we're going to come back to you. But Chloe, did you ever think, way back 12 years ago, when you reluctantly came to Bath, England, mm-hmm. brought by your husband, mm-hmm. that you would be where you are today?
Never.
What happened?
Well, my darling husband encouraged me to go to a Father Loves You conference in Bath City Church in 2003 in March. And bearing in mind that I hated the word father, like hated, I had a very bad upbringing with my wife too much in our house. My mom and my dad divorced when I was about 8 or 9 years old. And so I grew up simply hating men and hating the thought of a father. And my darling husband said, come on, babe, let's go to the Catch the Fire conference, the Father Loves You conference in Bath City Church. And I'm like, what? I hate the word father. Why would you do this to me? And at the time, I looked at him and I said, and how come you want to come? Because you don't like charismatics. And it was like, there was this kind of like inbuilt fight, but we just knew that we had to go.
Now, before that, Chloe, when Stu married you, he knew that the doctors had told you that when you would be around 30 years old, mm-hmm. you would be in a wheelchair.
Yeah.
Why was that?
Throughout my childhood, I seemed to get a lot of sicknesses, and I had 5 major diseases, and one of those was chondromalacia patella. And it's a degenerative disorder behind the kneecaps. And when I went to see my consultant surgeon, it got so bad. And he did some x-rays, did some MRI scans. And he said, I'm really sorry, but there's really not a lot we can do. You'll be in a wheelchair by the time you're 30. And even when we were first married, Stu used to have to carry me up and downstairs, help me put my shoes on. And life was really hard. And so I had a form of arthritis at the age of around, it started around 18, 19, that just got worse and worse and worse. And nothing would fix that, basically.
And so you came to the Catch the Fire conference in Bath, mm-hmm. and what were you speaking on that night?
The Father loves you. And forgiveness. Uh-huh. Oh. Mm-hmm. And I said to Stu as we were driving down, I said, you know what? I don't need to cry. I don't need any of this stuff. I'm just going to go and observe. And from the moment we walked into the back of the church, there were about 1,700 people there, if I remember rightly. And I just felt this kind of wall of whatever it was at the time that I then realized was just sheer beautiful love just kind of oozing into me. And I'm like, I can't cope with this. And I just cried and cried from the moment we literally went in on the first session.
And then when we did the importance of forgiveness, what happened?
I remember feeling I've forgiven my earthly father so many times for the abuse and for how I saw him treat my mom. And I've forgiven and forgiven, but the penny dropped when, you just got to choose to forgive from the heart. Yeah. And I'd realized for so long I was choosing to forgive, but it wasn't really from here. It was that I choose to forgive you, but you owe me. Yeah. You know, there was still that thing in my heart that said, you owe me something. Yeah. And I deserve something back. And I'm the victim. And so for the first time, I chose to forgive my earthly father from my heart.
And you came up to the front for the altar call. Mm-hmm. And you were just absolutely wailing.
I was. We actually got the videos back, and I watched them with my husband. And I'm like, babe, listen to that girl. She's just like screaming and screaming, that poor little treasure. And Stu turned around and he said, honey, that was you. And you're like, oh my goodness me. I mean, in that moment and remembering that moment, it was videotapes of images going through my mind. And I was just releasing judgment and hatred and all kinds of things from my heart.
And then what happened when you kind of finished after that?
When I finished after that, I thought, yay, I forgive, and I felt great, but there was then a call forward for worship leaders to come and be blessed. So I turned to Stu and I said, you know, I can go up and I don't have to cry. And as we went forward to receive an impartation, I didn't know, I'd never met you before, yeah. And I had my eyes shut and we were praying, I was ready to receive, and then this lady just laid hands on me, and I just remember being out of it, completely out of it. And she stayed with me and soaked me for about 30, 40 minutes, if yeah. I remember. Yeah. And you just, it was the lady said at the time, just receive your healing. And as she said, receive your healing, I felt this heat from the top of my head, yeah. right the way through to the bottom of my toes. I'd had 12 seizures a day of epilepsy up to that point. Mm-hmm. I could barely walk. I'd had lactose intolerance, cysts on my ovaries, and a migraine that lasted 6 months. That was the state I was in when I came to the conference. And as the heat, this love, just went from top to toe, I'm just like, whoa, I don't have any tummy pain. And I was feeling all this stuff, and it was you, yeah. and you said, receive your healing. I see the anointing of Moses, the glory of Moses on you, receive your healing. And I just looked and I said, I don't have any pain anymore. What is with that? My stomach stopped, the knee pain stopped, the headache had gone. Yeah. And you just said, come on, let's give testimony. And the next thing I know, you'd walked me up the stairs onto the platform, which I could not do previous to that moment.
Right.
About 1,697 people had come forward to forgive someone. Three people were left in the in their chairs. As I came up onto the platform, my darling husband, who was way back in the chairs, he's like, my wife, you can't walk like that. What in the world has happened to you?
Yeah.
And we got up and John just said, test your healing, kneel down. And I'm like, well, up until this point, I couldn't kneel.
Right.
I couldn't, and I was bouncing up and down on my knees, and I'm like, I'm healed, completely healed in my legs.
Woo! So we want to give glory to Jesus.
Come on.
And you know what? If you're sitting there thinking you don't have a destiny and you don't have a calling, this girl did not have any idea of what God was going to do. Neither did this man in faith and in love. When he said, Cole, I want to marry you, knowing full well that she was going to be a cripple probably by the age she was 30. Now look at what's going on. It's just awesome. Jesus, we give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. Woo! Pray, yeah.
Yeah, and you know what? We went to the doctor and we said, look, the Lord has healed my knee, so surely the epilepsy has gone. And I'm not lactose intolerant, the migraine is gone. And she turned to my veterinary surgeon husband and said, well, you're not fanatical, so I guess you're a vet, so help her come off her drugs month by month, and if anything happens, you go back on them, you increase the dose. So over a year, with the doctor's understanding and blessing, we came off the drugs, and I've been off the drugs for epilepsy since 2004 as well. No more seizures. So Father, I thank you that you are absolutely the God of all possibilities. We thank you. You're our healer. You're our deliverer. You're our restorer. And Father, I ask now that anyone who has heard this testimony, whether in this room or over the internet, Father, on the television, I ask that you would radically pour out your love into their heart so they can cry, Abba, and know that you are the world's perfect daddy. Father, we ask that your kingdom will come and your will be done. And that, Lord Jesus, epilepsy, arthritis, migraines, lactose intolerance, anything that I've spoken out, that the testimony of Jesus is a spirit of prophecy, and that you would receive your healing now and be radically transformed by your Papa's love in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Well, Steve.
It's a great story. We had, for those of you that are watching all around the world, we had the privilege on Monday night of having Benny Hinn here, and Benny Hinn has been a friend of John Arnott, our founding pastor, for 40 years, John. You used to go on a date with Carol and Benny with, I guess he wasn't married to Suzanne, another story. They were best friends, and John was a travel agent at that time and paid for his very first ministry trip. So they were buddies. So Benny was here,
Yep.
And you're one of these guys when you're prayed for that nothing externally seems to happen, correct?
Usually, yeah.
You call yourself an oak of righteousness as opposed to a willow of submission or something like that.
I'm a strong man in the anointing. interestingly, we were with our sister church in Raleigh, North Carolina, on Sunday, and I actually was preaching, and in part of my preach, I said, I very rarely manifest. I'm very open to it, but it's not something that happens to me a lot. And then when Benny was praying...
Something happened on Monday night when Benny was here. What happened?
Well, I was in a really bad mood at the time because... Benny was going around and a load of people were being blessed here, and then a load of people got blessed here, and then I was over here and a load of people got blessed there, and I was the only one still standing. And I don't know if other people would acknowledge my experience, but when you're all holding hands and everyone else hits the deck, it can be a lonely place. Still stood there. And so I was stood there blessing everyone who was around me. And Benny just came and actually picked us out, Chloe and myself, and he brought us forward. And I get a little bit intimidated in those situations in the past because I'm just used to nothing happening. Yeah. And so inside, I'm just thinking, oh no, it's Benny Hinn and nothing's gonna happen. And when he prayed for me, the only way I can describe it, it was as if four guys had run at me with a telegraph pole.
Electrical pole for North Americans.
Electrical pole, yeah.
Electricity pole.
There was this thing that hit me in my abdomen that was about this wide, and I don't remember a whole lot after that.
Well, what I was on the floor as well, so I didn't see it, but what I was told, what I was told was like you folded in half.
Well, you would if a telegraph pole hits you in the abdomen. Apparently, my legs went up and my body came down, and three times I flew back.
Okay. So, Stu, what we've learned over 20 years of revival is the touch is nice, but if it doesn't do anything, it's just nice. So what was God doing on the inside?
Well, when I was laying on the floor, I just heard the Father say, you've walked in grace and you've seen miracles in London and in Africa, but are you ready for an infusion of power into your life? And so obviously I had to pray about that. and I just said, yes, God, I am ready for an infusion of power into my life, and I choose never to be the same again. And ever since then, it's interesting, during worship, I can feel it now, this tingling on my skin where the electrical pole hit me. I'm just ready for an upgrade in power in our life, in our marriage, and in our ministry.
Well, Jesus, do that. Jesus, do that. If you're here in the room tonight, if you're watching anywhere, can you stand up if you would like a little bit more? If you need God's power, authority, anointing, Stu? Carol, he's got to pray first. All right. That leaves me. Oh, how about you put your hand? Can you pray? Okay. Go ahead, Stu. Release.
Father, would you come with everything of heaven and release a power infusion into every person that is desiring an encounter with you. God, it comes through your love, it comes through your grace, it comes through your mercy, but we desire your power as well.
Jesus in John chapter 7 said that out of your innermost being will flow rivers of living water. That sounds a lot like a life experience. Would you agree? Put your hand on your belly, right over top of your belly button. Oh, Holy Spirit, just close your eyes. Let's just receive a little bit right here. Holy Spirit, we welcome you to come. Would you begin to turn that tap on? Holy Spirit, we welcome your presence. Welcome your presence. Now, I want you to think, is electricity and water a good thing? What happens when electricity and water go together? It's just like it's just an explosion. So those of you that are beside someone in the room here, put your hand on their tummy. Have them put their hand on your tummy. If you're at home and someone's right there with you, just touch their tummy right now. Father, out of our innermost being. May those rivers flow. May the anointing of the...
Ha! Father, fill us up, fill us up, fill us up, fill us up, fill us up. Oh, we so love your presence, Lord. We want more and more and more of you, Holy Spirit. We love what you do. We love your ways. Ah, and we just thank you, Lord, that you totally blow us out of the box that we think we're in. So, I want to introduce to you tonight the most wonderful man in the whole wide world. And it's not just because he's my husband, but he is a lover of Jesus, a lover of people, a lover of the Holy Spirit. And it's just, he has been my mentor, he has been my teacher, he has been my encourager, and I want you to give him a great big hand, John Arnott.
Oh, my goodness. What a wonderful time already. Hello? It may be that some of you are here for the very first time, and you're wondering, what in the world have you got yourself in for? Somebody next to you, just reassure them, will you? Tell them it's going to be okay. It really is going to be okay. And we've been enjoying the rich presence of the Holy Spirit for 21 years now. He's come at a whole new level. And we're all just bristling, or at least around on our team here and many in our network, because we have this sense that God is about to just break out again at a whole new level. How many are ready for that? No, you're not. No, you're not. You may think you are, you may want to be, but I'm telling you, he is going to come in power and, take us all to a whole new level of his presence. And I'm just not sure what it's going to look like. We had to learn about the joy of the Lord at first, and we discovered how much fun the Holy Spirit actually is as a person. Now, we should have figured it out because we knew about the gifts of the Spirit, you know what they are, love and joy and peace and so on. And so we should have picked up on the joy part, but I'm not sure we really did until we were in the middle of it, and he was just playful. I don't know of any other word for it. But as we enjoyed his presence, month after month, then year after year, we really became aware that this whole thing, this whole emphasis of God is going somewhere. And he is going after the greatest harvest the world has ever seen, while at the same time, he wants to call you and I into health and soundness, and he just wants to come and bind up the brokenhearted and heal the bruised and set the captives free. And so we've had thousands, hundreds of thousands of testimonies of how God has come on people, like you saw here with Stu and Chloe, and their testimony was, I was just undone by the love of God. I didn't know he loved me like this. I didn't know he cared about me like this. And so it's just been an absolute amazing thing to see what God has done. How many have had their lives revolutionized by the Holy Spirit somewhere along the way? All right. Well, we just want to talk for a few minutes about the anointing that is touching every heart and every person. And I like to call this honoring the anointing. And so let's open with a scripture from John chapter 6, verse 63. If you have your Bibles there, that would be really great to get into that one for me. John 6, 63 says this. It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak, says Jesus, are spirit and they are life. So there's a couple of ways of looking at things. One is looking in the natural, looking in the flesh, but the other is looking in the spirit. And so as you and I desire more of him, we have to realize that he's called us into a way of holiness. He's called us into discipleship. He's called us into a way of peace and a way of love. And a big part of it is not just giftedness, but it's also character and character development. And I like to remind myself and our friends that, you know, there's qualities that the Lord is looking for in you and I. And let me just say the first one is character. So he's looking for people who keep their word. He's looking for people who are honorable. He's looking for people that that their promises are good and they pay their bills and they honor their relationships and things like that. And to those people, he wants to entrust a greater anointing and power and giftedness upon them so that you can carry his anointing with integrity. How many want to do that? How many want more, first of all? And you want to carry that with integrity, yes? I often ask this question. You know, there were two young men anointed by a mighty prophet named Samuel. He anointed Saul with oil, and the Holy Spirit came upon him. He anointed David with oil, and the Holy Spirit came upon him. Whose anointing would you like, Saul's or David's? How many say David's? Well, actually, they are both identical. You see, what you do with it is the issue, and whether you carry it with integrity. And actually, I think David sinned more than Saul did, but he knew to run to the Lord in repentance. And so that's what we're holding out for all of us, and we want to see that character is developed in us so that we can be competent in the anointing of God and then have the right motive of the heart. You know, you're not in it for the money or the fame or any of that. You have the right motivation of the heart. And then behind you comes a track record or a history of faithfulness. How many understand? So with that in mind, we want to look at different things that can hinder us and then focus in on one that is honoring versus dishonor. So I figured out over the years that there are certain things that help and certain things that hinder. How many know faith helps? I'm excited to have Kenneth Copeland here, and hopefully he's going to talk to us about faith. He probably knows more about that than almost any man alive, I suppose. But fear can get in the way and hinder faith. I remember when we were wanting to buy this building, and it was like, oh my goodness, they want over $2 million for this. And it was a steal, but still, it was a fortune for us, wasn't it, Steve? And we had to step out in faith and say, this is God, we're going to go for it, and we'll live with the consequences. And you know, the Lord backed us up, and it was an amazing time. But fear can come against faith. Similarly, pride will come against you, and the antidote for that is humility. And God has called us to be generous, but sometimes stinginess and fear of giving gets in the way. And Carol was mentioning, or Steve was mentioning, our book on grace and forgiveness. We found that unforgiveness is such a grace blocker that it has just short-circuited so many people and robbed them of their blessing. And we'll be talking about that very thing in a few days when we're speaking on that issue. But then I want to talk about honor versus dishonor. And that's really our topic tonight, especially when it comes to honoring the anointing. And finally, we can have love or legalism. Legalism will get in the way. How many want to flow in the love of God? Well, we want to get in the Spirit. Just have a little chat with yourself right now. Say, get in the Spirit. Don't get all critical. Don't get all analytical. Don't get in the flesh. Don't watch just focus on Jesus. Just have a good look at him right now for a moment and let him come upon you and touch you. Jesus honored the anointing that was on his life. And when we look at a scripture that I want to turn to now from Mark chapter 6, verse 4, we have the story of when Jesus returns in the power of the Spirit to his own hometown of Nazareth. And he is shocked that the people there did not receive him. And I'll come and read a parallel passage of this in a minute from Luke chapter 4. But Mark 6 verse 4 says this: a prophet is not without honor except in his own country and among his own relatives and in his own house. And I read that verse for years without wondering why that would be. I just accepted it. That's kind of the way it is. The people who know you well are sometimes the last ones to honor the anointing that God has put upon you. And so Jesus, when he returns, Nazareth is given a wonderful opportunity that they blew, quite frankly, because Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit. And they didn't honor him, and therefore they missed that opportunity. So let's go now to Luke chapter 4, verse 14. And I'm going to read this passage to you. It says that Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and news of him went out through all the surrounding region. And he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. So he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. And he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah, the scroll of Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted and proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind and to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." Then he closed the book and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. I want to pause there for a minute. Jesus read this scripture, but I don't think he read it like a reader would read it. I think he read it under the anointing because, see, he's returning in the power of the Spirit. He's bringing life into this community where he grew up, and he knows that this is a Kairos time and a Kairos moment, and so he read it, and I think it would have sounded like this: "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who were oppressed, and proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Then he closed the book, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. And the eyes of all who were in the synagogue were fixed on him. People were staring at him. They'd never heard anybody read the scripture like that. And he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your ears." And all bore him witness and marveled at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. But then something shifted. And they said, there was a group that said, "Wait a minute, is this not Joseph's son? Who does he think he is reading scripture like this?" This is my paraphrase now. And he said to them, "You will surely say this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself. Whatever we've heard done in Capernaum, do also here in your country.'" And then he said, "Assuredly, I say to you, no prophet is accepted in his own country." Now let me pause there for a minute till we finish the rest. Why is it that a prophet or an anointing is not recognized by the people who know you best, the people who you grew up with? What do you think? Familiarity can breed contempt, can't it? And they're like, "Wait a minute, we know this kid. We know who he is. This is Joseph's son. We know what he's like. He grew up around here. Who does he think he is? He's no man of God. He's an ordinary kid." And then he begins to turn up the heat, so to speak. "No prophet's accepted in his own country." What's he saying? He's embracing and honoring his own anointing right here. He read it under the anointing, and he's not ashamed of his own anointing. This is not boastful on his part. He's not going around saying, "Hey, I'm anointed now. I'm the Messiah now, you know." There's not that going on, but he's truthfully honoring the anointing that came upon his life. He was baptized by John. The Holy Spirit came mightily upon him. The Father affirmed him. He was 40 days tested in the wilderness, and then he returned and came back in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amazing. And then he says this, "I tell you truly, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a great famine throughout all the land. But to none of them was Elijah sent except to Zarephath in the region of Sidon, to a woman who was a widow." To a Gentile woman who was a widow. "And many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elisha the prophet, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." So all those in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath. I mean, they were really angry. "And they rose up and thrust him out of the city, and they led him to the brow of the hill on which their city was built, that they might throw him down over the cliff." Whew. How many can see this city really missed it? They had a golden opportunity if ever there was one. I mean, it may have been Jesus might have set up his headquarters in Nazareth. He went there first, and he had family and friends there. And yet, when he said this to them, this was like saying, "Why is it that the people of God are forever missing the blessing of God? Why is that? Don't you know, Elijah, even though there were many widows in Israel, was sent way over there to a Gentile woman? And don't you know, there were many lepers in Israel in the time of Elisha, and none of them were cleansed except Naaman the Syrian. They tried to throw him over the cliff, but he got away. And so let's look at this scripture together about Naaman, because I think we can learn some things from him. And so turn to 2 Kings chapter 5 and verse 1. I'll just highlight it. We're not going to read it all. But Naaman was a commander in the army of the king of Syria. He was a great and honorable man in the eyes of his master, because by him the Lord had given victory to Syria. But he was a leper. The Syrians had gone out on raids and brought back a young captive from the land of Israel, and she waited on Naaman's wife, a young girl. And then she said to her mistress, "If only my master were with the prophet who is in Samaria, he would heal him of his leprosy." Now, this is amazing. We have to see the need here. Here's a great general, very favored in his country, but he has leprosy, and no doubt he had money. He tried everything, and nothing's helping. And this little slave girl in his house tells the wife, who told the husband, that the little girl said, "There's a prophet in Israel who could help you." Doesn't that sound like a long shot to you? Go over there into the enemy's land, and there's a prophet there who can help you. But he grasps at it. You know, faith, something came alive in him, and he went to his king and told him the story, and the king wrote a letter, and he departed, taking like about $1 million with him in gold and silver and things, and he goes to the king of Israel with a letter that says, "Here's Naaman, my servant, cure him of his leprosy." The king of Israel thought, this is just he's provoking us to war here. This is not legitimate. And he tears his clothes in anger and thinking that he's seeking a quarrel with me. Now look at verse 8. When Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent to the king saying, "Why have you torn your clothes? Please, let him come to me and he will know that there is a prophet in Israel." Now what's he doing there? He's honoring the anointing that's on his life truthfully. He's not boasting, and he's not just bragging and you know, all of that. I think this is true, and it's honest. He's acknowledging that he has a call of God for things, and he's getting a quickening from the Lord to do something about it. Send him to me, and he's going to find out that there's an anointing and an anointed man of God in Israel. So the whole scene now begins to move over to Elisha's house. Naaman went with his horses and chariot and stood at the door of Elisha's house, and he knocks on the door. And it may be that Elisha was going to go answer because he was the one who called for this, but he gets a check in his spirit from the Lord, and the Lord is saying to him, "Not so fast. There's another ingredient that we need to deal with here, one called pride. And so what we need to do is carefully set this up so that Naaman can choose humility and therefore access the blessing that needs to come as he honors the anointing that was spoken over him by the man of God." So he takes one of his young men, one of his interns, one of his understudies, and he says, "Go answer the door and tell the general out there, give him this message. Go wash yourself in Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored to you, and you shall be clean." So I want you to picture this. There's a knock on Elisha's door, and he says, "Son, just go answer the door and tell the great man out there that he's to go take a bath in the Jordan and be clean, dipped himself seven times. Now you can imagine if there's anything that would really infuriate a leper, it's someone to say, "Why don't you know you're unclean, why don't you go take a bath or something?" And so Harry comes and this young man is saying, "Hello, the man of God says, go take a bath, dip yourself seven times in the Jordan and you'll be clean. Okay, bye." And now Naaman is absolutely furious. And see, here's where he almost missed it. He is about to dishonor the anointed word that came to him and therefore dishonor the anointing. Naaman became furious and he went away. And he said, "Indeed, I said to myself, he'll surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the place and heal the leprosy. Are not the Abana and the Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean?" So he turned and went away in a rage. What's about to happen? He's about to dishonor the anointed word, and he's about to miss his blessing. But he had some friends. Thank God for godly friends, or sensible. I don't know how godly they were, but at least they reasoned with him. And they said, "My father, listen, calm down, listen. If the prophet had told you to do something great, would you not have done it? How much more than when he says to you, wash and be clean?" You know, when we come to the Lord, when we have a need, and we're addressing two things right here with this. Number one, you and I stepping out in our anointing. And number two, people who need their miracle. There's expectations that we have about the way that this is going to go. And if I can just get Carol to pray for me, or if I can just get Kenneth Copeland to pray for me, you know, then... But you can't really take it if a little 8-year-old child comes up and says, "The Lord's told me that I'm to pray for you and you're going to receive your healing." And you're like, "What?" You know, because our expectations almost preempt that thing. How many are happy to let God do it his way? His way always invariably involves humility, okay? And so they reasoned with them, and he calmed down. Verse 14, so he went and dipped seven times in the Jordan according to the saying of the man of God, and his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child. He was clean. Imagine what he's thinking. First of all, he goes to the side of the river there. He takes off his general's clothes. How many visual people in the room right here? If you're watching at home, you know, you can picture this. Now there he is in his underwear. And what are his servants thinking? Oh my gosh, he's full of leprosy. And I've been close to him, and I've been helping him, and I don't want to get what he's got. See, now it's all out in the open. Everybody knows how bad this is. And so he goes out in the river feeling really humbled, really vulnerable, and he goes under the first time, and he looks, is there any change? Is there anything happening? No change. He goes under again, comes up again, third time, fourth time, no change, no change. What's going through his mind? What's the devil telling him? You are making an absolute fool of yourself, aren't you? This was such a harebrained idea, coming over to Israel of all places to get your healing. But he pressed through, honoring the anointed word. Five times, six times, seven times, and on the seventh time, his flesh becomes like the flesh of a little child. Wow. He returned to the man of God, he and all his aides, and they came and stood before him, and he said, "Indeed, now I know that there is no God on all the earth except in Israel, Now, therefore, please take a gift from your servant. Now, here comes the second miracle. The man of God says, as the Lord lives before whom I stand, I will receive nothing. When's the last time you heard a man of God refuse the offering? That's the second miracle right there. And he urged him to take it, but he refused. Naaman honored that word from Elisha and chose to look to him after the spirit rather than after the flesh, like he did at first. See, we can get this so wrong. And when we know one another, kind of grew up with one another, when the Holy Spirit comes mightily upon somebody, we need to get a new opinion of them, and we need to get a whole new understanding of them now, because even though at one level they're still the same people, they're changed and transformed because of the anointing. And I remember here one time when we were with, we just finished the service, and I went to the back, and there's a guy comes to our church, his name is George Alfred, and him and I went to high school together, and he was just having a laugh, and he says, John, I just can't get over it. You, of all people, you know, leading this revival, and, you know, people are wanting you all over to here and speak there and do all this stuff, and ha, 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 this is just the funniest thing ever. And we had a really good laugh about it at the back, you know. And what's going on? He's remembering me from high school days. And I'm telling you, that was the flesh. How many understand? And so, yes, that was the most unlikely thing of all. We had no idea, ever. But you see, what happened was the Holy Spirit entered the picture, and John Arnott got revolutionized by the Holy Spirit. And so that high school guy, that guy died. And we want to keep him dead, really. And so there's a whole new anointing that came. And so this is where we need to look now. We want to look after the Spirit. And so it's coming alive to me now that it ought not so to be that a prophet is not honored in his own hometown. That's just often the way it is. Why? Because people are looking after the flesh rather than after the Spirit. And so it is that if we could just get so-and-so to come, if they would fly across the ocean and come, if we could just get Benny Hinn to come or Kenneth Copeland to come or something like that. And when Dan and I go somewhere and Carol and I go and Duncan and Steve, you know, we get in an airplane and fly somewhere, all of a sudden we're these great men of God. We're at home. Well, it's just John and Carol after all, isn't it? You see how that works? Can you relate to that, Lou? Yeah. But if we're not careful, we can begin to dishonor the anointing that is right there in front of our eyes. Now, Jesus pointed it out. He said, listen, there were many widows in Israel, and God didn't send Elijah to any one of them. And think about it. There were many lepers in the time of Elisha. Not one of them were healed. Why not? Maybe they knew things about Elisha. Oh, I don't think he's so spiritual. He just had a row with his wife, and the whole neighborhood heard it. He's not all that spiritual. And see, people come up with reasons, and they pick up on your shortcomings, let's call them, and they use that as an excuse to dishonor the anointing that the Lord has put on your life. Now, if you're a pastor here, I want you to just start to receive appropriate honor for the anointing that you carry on your life. If you're a pastor, a missionary, an evangelist, a worship leader, or you have an office like that in the church, in the global picture, I want you to just wave your hand at me. So that would be me. Why don't we, let me have you all stand for a moment. Just stand where you are. Now let's honor these people. Can we just give them a big applause and say, God bless you all. God bless you all. Thank you for laying down your lives for the ministry and for the kingdom of God and for going for it and believing God and exercising your faith and going for it. And as I received this message a while ago, you can take your seats, I realized that I had been guilty of dishonoring the anointing on my pastors that I had over the years, because I tended to look at them after the flesh rather than after the spirit and after the anointing that God had given. And so rather than being an encouragement to them, I got in the way. How many understand? How many have ever done that? And so we've dishonored the anointing. Now, there's another person, perhaps, that we've dishonored the anointing on. And this one's a little closer to home. That person is you. How many have been filled with the Holy Spirit again and again? But then when it comes time to pray for someone or to serve, you think, oh, well, I can't really do that. I'm too old. I'm too young. I have never been to Bible school. I'm not good in front of people. I'm this, I'm that, I'm this, I'm that, I'm the other. And you come up with this whole load of excuses. But see, what are you doing? You're looking at yourself after the flesh. And I want you to start to look at yourself after the Spirit of God that rests upon you, the Spirit of God that lives within you, the Spirit of God who is mighty to save and to do great exploits through little old you. And you know what? God delights in using the little things, the things that are of no account, the things that have no reputation, the things that are not, as you read it in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, he loves to do that. Why? So that no flesh would glory in his presence. I want you to make a decision with me. I'm going to honor the anointing that God has put in my life right here. And I'm going to step up because we're about to enter a season of harvest like the world has never seen it, and it's all hands on deck. I was talking with Gordon, the director of our school, earlier today. And I said, Gordon, I have a book for you. And I gave him one called In the Day of Thy Power by Arthur Wallace. And I said to him, how I wish I'd have had that book in 1994 when everything was poured out here on us. And he said, why? What's it about? I said, well, he's analyzing how revival works. And revival fell in the New Hebrides. And so about 10 years or 12 years after that had happened, he sent a team to the New Hebrides to see if anything was still going on. And what he found was this. 10 years on, not a trace of the revival. And he was shocked, you know, not a trace, nothing, no Holy Spirit, no salvation. I mean, it was just dead. And he began to wonder, what about the Welsh revival? And so he sent a team to Wales, and they interviewed people who were a part of the Welsh revival, and they found out the same thing, that 10 years on from the day it started, not a trace of the revival. You think, what happened? Let me tell you what happened. The denominational leaders came in to put it in order, quotes. And they said, all right, all you children, all you kids, you young people, you sit down. All you women, you're not to be speaking in the church. You all sit down. We will only have seminary-trained ministers in our pulpits. Thank you very much. Now, there's nothing wrong with being a seminary-trained person, except to say that if God wants to do it his way and you come in and say, no, we're not having that, we're going to do it our way, guess what? You just moved away from the spirit into the flesh. And the flesh profits nothing. And so here we have, the onus is upon us to follow the anointing of the Holy Spirit and begin to view ourselves as sons and daughters of the living God that have been chosen by him to carry an anointing that's going to make the difference in a global revival around the world. How many are up for it? Now, let me just say, you're not going to do it in the flesh. You're going to do it only in the spirit if you're going to have fruitfulness following after you. I want you to honor the anointing that is on your life. You're not too old. You're not too young. You're not too poor. You're not too untrained. The fact that you've not been to Bible school, that doesn't matter either. There's just a whole load of things. I mean, you can get training and study the Word of God along the way, but I want you to step into the anointing that God has placed upon your life. How many are up for that? We want to go back to Luke chapter 4. And we're going to say this together. But we're going to read it like Jesus read it, because here's what he says about you from John chapter 14, verse 12. Truly, truly, I say to you. When Jesus says truly, truly, how many think it's probably true? He or she who believes in me, are you a believer in Jesus? Yes. Wave excitedly while heaven's looking down. He's looking, oh, that hand wasn't up there, that hand wasn't up there. If wave excitedly, I'm a believer. Okay. Okay, the works that I do, he will do also. Just hold the greater works for a minute. Think about that. What works did Jesus do? He healed the sick. He calmed the storm. Water into wine. Walked on water. Raised the dead. Cast out demons. Multiplied food. How did he do it? By the anointing, by the Holy Spirit. See, so he's honoring the anointing that's on his life. That's how he did it. Now, can you put Luke chapter 4, verse 14 up on the screen for me? And I'd like us all to stand and read this. But I want you to put your will into it. And it's not just a prayer or a wish for the future. But this is something we're going to step into right now. Now, Benny Hinn had a wonderful point that he made. The anointing is in you for you, but on you for others. And so we want both aspects of that, don't we? Because we want to be men and women of integrity and full of prayer and full of God and, be worthy carriers of the anointing. But we also want to put that anointing on so that we can be fruitful in ministry and therefore bring glory to the Lord. Yeah? So let's read this together. Sorry? No, I want, yes, I do, Steve. Sorry, thank you. I want verse 18, guys, 18 and 19. Let's read it together. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty those that are bruised, and to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Now give Jesus a big shout here. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and I make no apologies for it. I'm really, really thankful that has happened. How about you? I love it when the anointing starts to show up on people, ordinary people. One of the joys of my life is to see my wife and my daughter and my granddaughter moving in the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And all our friends like Steve and Duncan and Dan and 101 others, Stu and Chloe and many others, moving in the anointing of the Holy Spirit and embracing that which God has put upon them. Now I want you to reach up and take your anointing and pull it down and just treasure it in your heart here. I want you to guard it and protect it and treasure it and honor it all the days of your life. Jesus said, if I can't trust you with money, who's going to give you the true riches? He was speaking of the anointing. He's looking for people that he can trust with more. And more is on the way, friends. Now I want us to say this scripture one more time. Can you put it back up, guys? Verse 18. And embrace it now. Ready? The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, and to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Give him another mighty big shout right here. And I want to encourage all of us, myself included, to start honoring the anointing wherever we go. If people are different than you, if they're lovers of Jesus and they're carriers of the anointing of the Holy Spirit, honor that in them. This is going to take the global church to reach the global world. We've got billions of lost people that need to know that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, the Savior of the world. How many feel that you're just bristling in the anointing right here? Well, one more thing. When the anointing is upon you, you can't just hide it away and, you know, keep it someplace for a rainy day or whatever. The anointing flows like a river. And if you try to bottle it up and keep it, it just kind of can, I don't know, it just becomes a swamp, it says. It just becomes ineffective. And so what we want to do is begin to give it away. And so how many need a miracle here tonight? You need a miracle. How many need a healing? How many don't need one, but you would like it anyway? I mean, think of something. Are there any perfect specimens in the room? If you're not a perfect specimen, there may be one or two things you would like. Hey, I'd like to lose a few wrinkles. I'd like to get rid of a few scars. I'd like more hair. I'd like to lose weight. I'd like my back, my neck, my this, my that. I mean, you know, whatever it is. Now, here was the message of Jesus. I mean, Carol and I do this everywhere we go. The message, first from John the Baptist and then from Jesus, was simply this. The kingdom of heaven is within your reach. The kingdom is at hand. And see, there's no sickness in heaven. There's no poverty. There's no shame. There's no pain. There's no accuser. You know, all the stuff that hinders the anointing is not there when the presence of heaven comes down. And so the kingdom of God is what is a way of saying a breakthrough of the Holy Spirit is coming into your life and taking care of the darkness and bringing you freedom and bringing you life and bringing you healing. And so when we kind of figured that out a little bit, I began getting people to just do just little childlike things like, come on then, if the anointing's within your reach, why not reach for it? Now, what I'm saying that for is the anointing is in you, but wants to come upon you. And so I want you to reach up like little children would do and get that thick, oily presence of the Holy Spirit all over your body, all over your hands. And you can try this at home, you who are watching at home on Daystar TV all around the world. Reach your hands up right now and get that glory all over them. And some of you are starting to experience this tingling, the weighty presence of the Spirit of God. And just bask in it for a minute. Just enjoy it for a minute. Now, I want you to turn to a person near you, behind you, beside you, and just ask them, what do you need from God? What do you need from the Lord right now? And then say to them, well, fortunately for you, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me, and He's anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted and heal the bruised and set the captive free. So I want you to lay your hands on them like the hands of Jesus. Let your hands become like the hands of Jesus. And you take authority over that sickness. Take authority over that pain. And you can take turns doing this, but one is giving, the other is receiving. And I want you to impart that anointing into your friend. Take authority over it. Rise up in the authority that Jesus Christ has given you. And say, I tell that pain to go in Jesus' name. I tell that spine to be straight. I tell that damaged nerve to be healed. I tell that sciatica to be healed right now. I tell that blind eye to see. I tell that deaf ear to hear right now in Jesus' mighty name. River of God, flow into my friend right here. Lord, flow into the people watching in their home right now. Let the kingdom of God come in power. Oh, Holy Spirit, your wonderful loving presence falls upon us in this place right now. I take authority over injury. I take authority over chronic illness. I take authority over some of the things Chloe mentioned. Seizures, we bind that in Jesus' name. Break the power of it right now. And arthritis in people and limitations in people. You know, heads and shoulders, knees and toes, all over, Lord, let the kingdom come. Now come on, rise up in your authority and you begin to do what Jesus said to do. He or she who believes in me, the works that I do, He will do also. Lord, we launch out and we do it. Now, maybe you want to quickly trade places. And if you're the one who's praying, you start receiving right now. Somebody's shoulder's just been healed right here. A freedom has come into that shoulder in the name of Jesus. A neck problem being healed here. I thank you, Lord. Someone's eye, you're receiving a healing in your vision. Another person gets floaties. You're always getting these floaty things in your vision. I rebuke that in Jesus' name. It goes in your mighty name, Lord God. Open those deaf ears, Lord God. That blood condition is healed in Jesus' name. That virus that won't let go, it dies in the name of the Lord as this person comes into health and strength. Now listen, you can keep going for a little while, but I want you to check yourself right now. And if you feel like something has happened to you, and if you have symptoms that you can check, you know, the pain has diminished or the pain has gone, or you have mobility that you didn't have, or something like that, I want you to wave your hand excitedly like something has just happened to me right here. Wave excitedly. Come on, wave excitedly so I can see what's going on. If that is you, I want you to run up to the front real quick. Get out of your seat into the nearest aisle. Are you listening to me? Get out of your seat and run up here real quick. Come on, come on, come on, come on. What's just happened, sir?
I had to limp coming in here. My foot was bothering me so bad.
Yeah.
And when the lady in front of me prayed for me, the pain went away. And when you said to run up here, I had to do it.
Jump up and down on it for me. Fire on him right here, Lord God. I thank you for it. Take it again, take it again. Come on, sweetie. Just bring them up either side. That's great. What's happened to you, my dear?
Well, I had a stroke 2.5 years ago.
A stroke, yes.
My right side, and it paralyzed my left side.
Yes.
And I was completely healed except for one little manifestation in my left foot. And it's caused a dystonia that causes distortion of the muscle. It keeps spasming.
And now?
Well, it doesn't hurt anymore. And you was hurting when I walked in, but it's not hurting now.
Jump up and down on it.
There's a little bit there.
Go on.
There's still a little there.
Fire of God come upon her here in Jesus' mighty name. Let it come. What's happened with you?
Well, I've been fighting candida, which is distended bowel,
right,
for about 3.5 years. And the guy that you just prayed for fell down. He and two other people prayed for me, and it's gone.
Gone. How do you know it's gone? The bloating went away.
Yeah, you told me to check myself, and there's no bloating.
Fill him up, Father, in Jesus' wonderful name. I thank you for it.
John,
what's happened here, Steve?
This lady had shoulder problem for many, many years.
Long, long, long time.
How long?
Long years in my shoulder. And yesterday I said, Lord, I'm coming tonight because I know I'm going to receive my healing. And when you speak, the lady, I told her, and she laid her hand now.
No pain. Who was the mighty evangelist that prayed for you?
Lady next door to me here.
That lady next to you. Fill her up, Jesus. Fire on her.
John Kell has been having problems in his hips, and the Holy Spirit's all over him.
This precious man has fixed hundreds of chairs in this place that people and the Holy Spirit broke them. Now he's fixing you, Cal. Fill him up. What's happening
here? This
is Joe.
He's had problems in his neck. Fusion.
I had a C1, C2 fusion, and I'm very stiff. And I was just prayed over, and the fire and the heat was just building in my neck, and now I can just really move my neck around.
How long has it been since you could do that?
Years.
Thank you, Holy Spirit.
John, this gal had floaters in her eyes, and they're completely gone.
How long have you had that?
I guess since I was 7 or 8 years old.
7 or 8 years old, and they're gone.
Completely gone.
Oh, completely gone, she said. Jesus, you're so awesome. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you.
John, this gal had neck problems just for a couple weeks, and they're all gone.
Neck problems. Move it. Wow. I'm very happy for you. Stretch your hands toward her and send the anointing up here. You know, when we say stretch your hands, it's not just, hey, we wish you well. Send the anointing up here. Let her have another dose of his presence in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. You, bless her. What's happened here,
this
Steve?
Gal had TMJ, John, in her jaw and was causing problems in the back of her head.
Back here.
And she's fine.
And it just feels so good. I mean, it's just the pressure's gone. The pressure that was back here constantly is gone. It's just amazing. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm so happy.
Breathe it in.
Pardon me?
Breathe it in.
I am going to breathe it in. I'm going to take all he wants to give me.
I hope that's not me doing that, Steve.
I have no idea what that is. That Whoa. Could just be the anointing.
Yeah. What happened?
This lady's... Go ahead.
I've had pain in my knee for a long, long time, I don't know, many years. And Charlene beside me laid hands on me, and the pain is gone. I was able to go up and down the stairs. Like even this morning, I found it hard to go up the stairs and down the stairs, but I actually ran. Sorry, I ran up the steps and down again. Jesus, thank you for healing.
Thank you, Jesus, for healing her, for healing her, for healing her.
We want you to switch microphones.
We have 4 minutes, but you know what? I think we should do this again. Why don't you stand up? You're going to pray for yourself this time. Tell the Lord what you need a miracle for. You know, my back, my stomach, my sugar, my glaucoma, my this, my that, whatever it is. Reach your hands up to heaven, mighty man and woman of God, and just realize that you have been graced by the anointing of the living God coming upon you. The kingdom is within your reach. Reach up, take a hold of it by faith right now. Bring that anointing down and lay it upon your own body. And you at home, do the same thing right here. Let God use your hands and your anointing that he has given you to bring the kingdom down to you. And say this with me. This healing belongs to me because of what Jesus has done. I receive my healing now. I receive my blessing now. I receive my new job right now. I receive healing in my family, my marriage right now. I receive it now in Jesus' name. Now lay hands on yourself and let it come right here in Jesus' name. All right.
Friends, thank you so much, and especially those of you who've been watching on Daystar TV. We've been really pleased to be a part of your night. We're going to be live back tomorrow night, Marcus and Joni Lamb. We'll see you tomorrow.
Give the Lord a big shout of praise right here. Come on. Bye-bye, Daystar. It's great having you. Now lay hands on yourself again right here and say, I am receiving the blessing that God has for me in the name of Jesus. Somebody's getting a healing in their leg right at this minute. Thank you, Father, for what's going on. Now then, I want you to check yourself, and if you had symptoms, you know, move, bend, twist, turn, you know, check out, see if you can see clear through that eye, or close your good ear and listen through the other one. Check yourself, and if you feel like we're really getting somewhere with this, get out of your seat, run up here, and let's hear what's going on.
John, this man has had incredible neck pain for, he can't remember how long, years and years, and shoulder pain, it's all gone.
Wow, where are you from, sir?
Moosonee, Ontario.
Moosonee.
I know about you.
All right. What? How long have you had pain, and what caused it?
See, I used to work in a butcher shop where it's ice and cold, right?
Yeah.
And off and on, when I was working there, even now, I'm 72 years old, I can feel the pain right my back here, especially on my neck, the muscle up here.
Yeah.
And that gentleman over there I just met tonight, when you said pray for one another, that thing just went. And I'm trying to get it back, and I can't get it back. Praise the Lord.
Fire on him right here, Lord. In Jesus' wonderful name. Whoa.
John, this wonderful girl had sciatic pain for 8 months, and it's totally gone. Oh.
Sciatica, and are you, like, it says visitor, are you in the school?
I just got here last night.
Wow.
How long have you had it again?
8 months.
Isn't Jesus great? Fill her up, Papa.
John, Ian couldn't swallow, and now he can. Woo!
This esophageal, whatever that issue was, and it was a blockage in my esophagus. And my brother here, Daniel, prayed for me, and the fire is just going up and down my esophagus right now.
Stretch your hands toward him. Come on. Send it up here. Fire on him. Oh, Lord.
We're going to open the doors, and anybody that wants some ministry,
we're
going to
transition in just a minute or two. But actually, for us at least, the night is still young. Now, I know you've been traveling. How many have come a long way and you're really tired right now? And you would just as soon go back to the hotel right now and go to sleep. I want you to feel free to do that. However, just to say that they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They'll mount up with wings like an eagle, run and not be weary, walk and not faint. And so, as we transition into a prayer time, here's what that's going to look like. We're going to open the doors at the back. Where's Mel or
she's
our
gone
security?
Back to open
she's
them.
Come back.
Yep.
And there's big, there's green lines on the carpet there. And you stand on one of those lines, face the bookstore, the exit. And what you do there is you keep waiting upon the Lord. And some of our ministry team will come along as we've done for 21 years, and they'll pray for you. And some unknown person, some little old lady, some yeah. little old person, some young person that God has anointed
yeah.
will come and lay hands on you. And miracles will happen, and you'll get filled and filled and filled again. Now, I want to say this for anyone who's never been here before, this is your first time. I want you to feel safe. This is not out of control. It has been the most wonderful thing that God has ever poured out upon us. But sometimes we need a couple of days, 2 or 3 days, just to kind of get the feel of what's going on. And realize this is God at work, and you want in on it. So you be perfectly free just to watch and observe, but don't do it too long. I want you to get in and receive from the Lord. How many want to do that? All right, so we're going to open the back and get some lights on. And how many ministry team do we have, Sandra? Wherever you went.
We have a bunch.
I'm going to need some help with catching.
Yeah.
And so we need some catchers, some guys to help, or some sturdy ladies. And there's a way to do it so you don't hurt yourself. You know, you catch them and you use your knees and stuff, but they'll instruct you. How many do we have, Michael?
61.
We have about 60 or so. So I need about 70 or 75 people that will help with catching. If you're willing to help. Now listen, catchers get a double portion, by the way. So we always pray for them. But if you will help us with catching, wave your hand at me. And okay, catchers, you can put your hands down now. And ministry team that needs a catcher, I want you to just kind of go to you can come to the front. Some of them are here, but some of them are halfway down the back or whatever. Ministry team that needs a catcher to help them, put your hand up right now. And Carol and I would like a couple each, maybe. But we're just going to transition now into a time of drinking deep of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said in John chapter 7, if anyone is thirsty, are you thirsty? If anyone is thirsty, let him come unto me and drink. And then out of their innermost being, there will flow rivers of living water. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to drink of him. Now, I still need three or four catchers here. We have some of our team with their hands up. Any of the ministry team still need help with a catcher? There's one way over there that needs help. But folks, go ahead and stand on the prayer lines. But I want you not just stand there sort of getting in the flesh and looking around. I want you to get into the Holy Spirit's presence and hunger and thirst after him and say, Lord, I really, really want to be filled tonight with the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. I want to be refilled with the glory of God. Are we ready? All right. Okay. Folks, just feel free to go to the back. You don't have to, as I said, but if you're willing, please go ahead and do that now. Ruth and Marcel are going to lead us in some music, and then we'll transition to a CD in a bit.